I'm posting this on YouTube in here. Sin is sin, and no sin at the end. You know, it angers me sometimes how some preachers can keep on sin just so they can receive more money or tithing or offering. I post this on Facebook, and I'm going to share it with you tonight. How can men just get married for a God and a preacher? I just love how people make up their own rules to justify their living in sin. I was talking to my mom about someone that got married, and she thought I was talking about my ex-wife. She told me she knew since Friday. I said, no, not her, someone else. But like I care that she's someone else's problem. But I can't believe a church would justify that as a legal marriage too. Just gives me another reason to never attend that certain local church. Come on, people, sin is sin, and no sin will enter in. Why do you think so many preachers condone sin, sinful behavior for a bigger tithe check? Some preachers will split hell wide open with the rest of the sinners. I couldn't care less about the marriage, or the so-called marriage, but what angers me is a church that condones that kind of sin. He's one of the ushers there, or used to be. This has got me started. I may do one more broadcast just on this topic tonight in a video or two for the YouTube. This goes with my message today of great falling away. Today, too many preachers are allowing sin behind pulpits. Sin is sin, people. Come on, it's time to wake up. It's time to wake up tonight. Sin is sin, and no sin is going to enter in. You can't condone sin tonight. Hidden sins damage lives. Joshua chapter 7 says, nobody likes problems. The fact is, though, that problems and struggles make us more dependent on God. They force us to turn to Him for help. When my finances are low, I pray for help. When my body is broken by illness or injury, I ask the Lord for healing or for strength to accept the thorn I've been given. Whenever there is a crisis or struggle, we turn to the Lord. On the other hand, there is also a danger in success. Success breeds carelessness. When everything is going smoothly, I get the mistaken ideal that I can handle things in my own strength and leave behind my trust in the Lord. One man described the danger of success with these words, for every 1,000 you can handle adversity, only one can handle success. Today's text comes from Joshua, illustrates this truth. Think about recent history of the nation Israel. God had helped them defeat the kings, establish a new leader in Joshua, stop the flow of the flood swollen Jordan River, that they can cross on dry ground. And finally, he defeated the powerful city of Jericho by miraculously collapsing their forfeited walls. All of this was a sign to the nation of Israel that God was with them. One victory after another had boasted their confidence to dangerous levels. Here is a first lesson we need to learn. We're extremely vulnerable to temptations in moments of apparent success. The next city on the agenda is Ai. Joshua sends men to spy it out. They send back the message, not all the people will go up against Ai. Send 2,000 or 3,000 men to take them. Do not weary all the people, for only a few men are there. Ai was a weak city. There was supposed to be an easy battle, but look what happened. So about 3,000 men went up, but they were routed by men of Ai who killed about 36 of them. They chased the Israelites from the city gate as far as the stone quarries and struck them down on the slopes.
noticed the secret of events. The hearts of the people melted and became like water. Joshua falls down and prays to God. Listen to Joshua's prayer. Joshua and the people have lost their former confidence. They are meeting in fear because of the weaknesses. Think about it. It wasn't some great and powerful nation who rooted them. It was the wimpy little weakly city of all. It's amazing sometimes how we can be victorious over some of the strongest and most powerful temptations you can imagine, but that allow the weakest and the smallest, most insignificant temptations to eventually become our downfall. The defeat had brought them to their knees before God. Their confidence in God, which had produced their success and victory, can very quickly turn into self-confidence. Notice God's reply to Joshua's appeal. Stand up. What are you doing down on your face? God will not tolerate Joshua's discouragement and attitude, pessimistic attitude. God has given them victory after victory, and then after one defeat, they're down on their knees, blubbering about how they should have been content to stay on the other side of the river. Read, we want it to be easy, don't we? How their enemies are going to hear about this, and they will wipe us out. You're not going to take care of us anymore, are you, God? Do you know somebody like that tonight? God's not going to if you're sinning. But if you're living for Him, He will. You know, I preached a message earlier today about a great falling away. You know, the Bible says in the last days there's going to be a great falling away. And so many people has had victory after victory. So many people has seen great and mighty things from God. So many people has seen great miracles happen. But somehow along the way, they've lost the sight of God. And there's going to be a lot of preachers that's going to split hell wide open. Because sin is sin, and no sin's going to enter in. And we can't condone sin. We can't condone sin because it may make a bigger paycheck for somebody. We can't condone sin because it will make some, because we want to please everybody and don't want to make nobody mad at us. You know, this God we serve is a very angry God, and He can be a very vengeful God. The God we serve don't want us to be enticed by fables, but He wants us to be enticed by the Word of God. He wants us to be rooted and grounded in the Word of God. The disobedience of just one individual can have a negative effect on the whole community. To uncover the identity of the one who sinned, God tells Joshua to line up the people tribe by tribe, family by family, household by household, man by man. Sanctification and purification are needed. The households of God had been dirtied, and it was time for the mess to be cleaned up. Some of us tonight have been dirty, and it's time for our mess to be cleaned up. And God will clean us up, and yes, God can forgive you. But you've got to want the change tonight. There is not one single person tonight that God cannot change. There is not one single person listening tonight that God cannot heal. There's not nobody tonight that God can't deliver. There's nobody tonight that God can't restore. But they've got to want to. They've got to want to get out of the past situation and move on to the glory of God and what God has laid upon your heart. Sin is sin, and no sin's going to enter in. If you're ready for what God wants you to do, you've got to get the sin out of your life. You've got to clean up your life. God says there's dirty things in the house to house, person to person. Let's get the sin out. Let's cleanse ourselves. Preachers, Let's stop condoning sin. Sin is sin. And no sin's going to enter in tonight. We want to make ourselves ready. We want to be ready for when He calls. In order to do that, we've got to get ourselves just right where God wants us. God's got a plan for each and every one of your lives tonight. What's that plan God has for you? I'm going to do this song one more time. Go and sin no more. People, it's time you go and sin no more. It's time you turn from your sinful ways. And you begin to let go. And let God tonight. Sinners, it's time to repent. Preachers, it's time to stop condoning. Look at the first picture that's on here. It had a stop sign. It says stop, seeing ahead. Stop. And begin to listen to the voice of God. The Bible says obedience is a better sacrifice. You can sacrifice all this world has to offer. But if you're not obeying God, you're going to split hell wide open. Thank you, and may God bless.